This Bible question is an excerpt from our television program, What Do the Scriptures Say? We hope that it will enrich your spiritual life, and we hope that you'll come back to www.scripturesay.com to find answers to your Bible questions. Thank you.
What that question really opens up is for me to talk about is, what is marriage all about? What is marriage biblically? And I, for just a couple of minutes this morning, I want to examine the origin of marriage. Some people have the idea that the institution of marriage was just a creation of man, that man came up with the concept. That is not the case. Marriage is, as I said last week, the second most important relationship known to man. The first is a relationship to God. Christianity is the most important relationship. But because marriage can either help or hinder your relationship to God, marriage is extremely important. And since marriage is no longer really respected by our culture, at least today people are brave enough to speak out and say, oh, you don't need marriage. You can live together, that's okay. Two people of the same sex can live together. All of these things are acceptable practices, where I know that they existed in the past in our country. I know that those relationships have always existed, but they weren't open. And marriage was not under the assault that it is presently in this country. And it is true that there are those who want to legislate marriage and make it acceptable for same-sex marriages. So, I think we ought to go back and look at the original. Now, this is not—we're not entering into mythological territory here. When we go back to Genesis chapter 2, we're actually looking at the history, human history. That's what Bible believers believe. This is the account of the creation of man, and in that historically accurate account, it tells us the purpose and what God had in mind. And I'd like you to read with me a couple of things here, beginning in Genesis chapter 2 and verse 18. Then the Lord said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make him a helper suitable for him." Out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every bird of the sky and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called a living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all the cattle, to all the birds of the sky, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helper suitable for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. Then he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh at that place. The Lord God fashioned into a woman the rib which he had taken from the man, and brought her to the man. The man said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. For this reason a man shall leave his father and his mother, and shall be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." Well, there's a lot of things that I want to talk about in this place, Danny. A lot of things that are interesting. God said, first of all, that it was not good for man to be alone. Adam was created first, and then God created his most significant creature. That gets me in good with my wife.
I find it interesting how God created man from the elements, but yet he uses a part of man to create the woman.
Well, and
he could have
gone back to the dust. In fact, that's one of the questions that I am frequently asked. Why did God choose to make her out of the rib? Why didn't he make her out of the dust of the ground? Mm-hmm. Well, the facts are that the information is not given there other than for Adam's statement, she's a part of man. It's to show the closeness of the relationship, and it's part of the, took out of the rib, he should be close, intimate with woman. The word woman in Hebrew means she-man. In our culture, that means something else altogether. But what it meant in the original was to show the close association that God intended for there to be between a man and a woman. They are literally one. And one of the things that I think is interesting here is sit back and look at this picture that is given to us of man's history. God created the animals and brought them to Adam and said, God could have named them, but he wants Adam to know that in all of the world and all of the of all of the creatures, there's nothing there that really will meet his needs as a human being. There's no one like him who can share his joys and his sorrows. And we can be very grateful that Adam didn't find a creature there. If you want to interject a little sense of humor here, I remember one time Kathy and I were asked to consider a position with a church. And I, in talking with the church, said, yeah, my wife and I would be glad to fly there. And they said to me, don't worry about bringing your wife. We just want you to fly down here. And Kathy and I said, wouldn't it be funny if we went there and we got a gorilla costume, you wore that, put a dress on there, and we danced in there, and don't worry about your wife, she's not important, and here's my wife. You know, we thought it's silly for people not to consider marital relationships as the most significant relationships of all when you're talking to people about jobs, and particularly preachers and others. And here we can be awfully grateful that Adam didn't find a companion among God's creation that would be a suitable helper. Now, in our politically correct world, helper is not a word that the feminists like to deal with. This is not a degrading terminology. This simply has reference to what we men must have in our relationships, someone to share our joys and our sorrows. We need help. We need help. Not many men are capable of saying that, but man was made not complete until he had a helper. In verse 23 helps us to see how closely Adam got that message when he said, she is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She is the she-man. That's the kind of relationship that God intended for the marital relationship to be. And verse 24 tells us God's design. It's if you look at verse 24, it's a little difficult to tell who's talking here, whether it's Adam or God. From what we learn in the New Testament in Matthew chapter 19, Jesus seems to suggest that these are the words of God. So what we have here is the institution of marriage. This is where it starts. And when we come back in just a minute, we'll look at some practical observations. There's some practical lessons that we should learn from this passage. Man should leave his parents for his wife, and a woman is, by the same authority, to leave her parents. I want to make some practical observations as we go through this. It's been my experience, I don't know about you, Danny, but it's been my experience when a man and a woman marry, if they will, I tell them in premarital counseling that it's best to cross two rivers in an ocean at least 500 miles away from their parents.
That's not bad advice.
I tell him that. And biblically, I believe that what he's saying here is that you leave your parents. Not all parents are willing to let go. Some mothers-in-law and some fathers-in-law.
You know, we blame the mother-in-law, but it is both.
Some just hold on to their kids.
I've got two daughters. I tell you, it's tough to let go of those daughters when you've been the male figure.
And then when the marriage occurs, then the family oversees the decision. That should not happen. But you see, the intimacy of the marriage is between a man and a woman. Man is joined to his wife, and the wife is joined to her husband. And they must not allow outside interference in anything. And it's up to them to make sure that doesn't happen. Primarily, it's on the head, the man, to make sure that doesn't happen. And he's got to make sure that his wife is on board. Now, let's go over to the New Testament and look at what Jesus says about this subject, because what he does is he quotes from the original intention that God has with regard to marriage. And I think it's very interesting in Matthew chapter 19. Look at verse 4. And he answered and said, "Have you not read that he who created them from the beginning made them male and female? And he said, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let no man separate." Now this is in the context of the Pharisees coming to him, trying to throw up a hypothetical that Jesus would stumble over. They wanted to get him any way that they could. And he takes them, and it related to marriage, he takes them back to the original plan. This is where marriage started. By God, the institution of marriage started. It started at the creation, in the very beginning. And notice the purpose that Jesus points to. Jesus points to the creation to teach the lesson that it was God's intention that there be one man for one woman and one woman for one man. There's a very interesting passage over in Malachi chapter 2 that the King James Version states so clearly. I want you to look at that verse, and we're going to change from the New American Standard 95 edition to the King James just for this verse, but read this verse with me. "And did not he make one? Yet he had the residue of the Spirit, and wherefore one? That he might seek a godly seed. Therefore take heed to your spirit, and let none deal treacherously against the wife of his youth." In this section, the context is Malachi is condemning the leaders of Israel because they were divorcing their wives and marrying others. And it's kind of like that old joke about, you know, I want to trade in my wife of 40 for two 20s. What Malachi says is God made only one. This is really significant. He could have made two women, or he could have made a man and a woman for Adam, if that's what God's original plan was. But he made only one, and God, and yet he had the residue of the Spirit. I love the way the King James says that. God had enough power at his disposal to make multitudes, if that's what was necessary to accomplish his purpose. But he wanted, this is really important, a godly seed. Marriage is a sanctified institution. It is precious. It is holy. It is God-ordained. And he made only one woman for one man because that is the design of marriage. And it doesn't matter what our state or any state or our nation or any nation does to redefine marriage. This is the biblical definition because God wanted a godly seed. Now, Jesus says that the two become one flesh. I want to try to unravel that a little bit, and let's see if we can determine what does it mean that the two become one flesh. We'll take a look at that when we come back in just a minute. Jesus said that the two become one flesh. There's lots of confusion about what does it mean that the two become one flesh. When I see Danny alone, I say, "Danny, where's your better half?" That's the way that married couples talk about their, and particularly about
the wives. Feminine. That's the way us guys talk about the wives,
yeah,
our better half.
They definitely are the better half. And so the two become one flesh. In what sense? How does that all work? The best commentator that I know of that looks at this came up with I think, as clear a statement as you can about this mystery is McGarvey. J.W. McGarvey says that by it the pair become one flesh, so that the man is as much joined to his wife as he is to his own body. And you say, that doesn't help me at all. What does he mean by that? Well, let me quote from the Apostle Paul then. In Ephesians chapter 5, read these verses with me. So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ also does the church. Well, you say, again, that sounds mysterious to me. I don't understand all of that. Well, that's exactly what Paul says in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 33. This mystery is great. This is one of those mysteries that even though we have an awful lot revealed, and a mystery is something, is simply something that has not been revealed, made manifest, this mystery remains a mystery in a sense because it's such a sacred institution. God designed marriage in such a way that, two people actually become one. Husbands are not to love their wives in the same degree that they love their own bodies, but they're to love their wives as though they're part of their body. There's a difference there. There's a difference there. She is actually part of you when you are joined together by God. The wife is a part of the husband. The two are one flesh. And that makes love more than an obligation, more than a compulsion. It makes love part of that relationship. You don't have to command someone to love part of their body. You cherish it and you nourish it. Husband nourishes, feeds is what that word really indicates or brings to maturity. Cherish literally means to keep warm. The husband cherishes his wife, keeps her warm, feeds her to maturity. And what's precious about this relationship is the analogy that Paul uses in Ephesians chapter 5, that this is what Christ does for the church. He loves the church. He cherishes the church. He brings the church to maturity through the Word. He's willing to give up anything for his bride, the church. And the husband should be willing to do whatever is necessary for his wife because we are members of the same body. Just as in the body of Christ, we are all members of one body. That's why the unity of the church is so important. Now, we've said all of that, Danny, to come to this conclusion based upon the question, what will you do when the state of Arizona requires you to marry gay couples? Marriage was never intended by God to be anything other than one man and one woman for life. That was the original institution. And whatever our culture decides to do with marriage, our culture can decide to do with marriage. But those of us that want to stick with the original plan will look back at the original concept and we'll live by those principles. We'll follow those principles. Whatever our culture decides to do, we can still stand up. It's all right to stand up for that which is right. Now, having said all of that in the last two episodes, let me say, do not become aggressive, hateful. Don't become terrorists against those who disagree with you. Christianity has no place for, you're not appointed by God to be the policeman to bring judgment upon others that don't follow what we've talked about. Your job is to teach the truth and to exhibit by example the truth. It's not your job to make sure that everybody toes the line. The simple answer to all of these problems is if we could get people in their hearts to accept Christianity, these problems in our culture would not be there. We could change the world if we could convert people to the truth of the gospel because the change comes from within. And people would follow those principles that we've talked about here in the last two episodes. Don't go out there and hurt people who disagree with you. in their ignorance, I might add.
Well said. Well said. Stay tuned and we'll be right back.
We thank you for your interest in What Do the Scriptures Say? We hope that you will come back to scripturesay.com often for answers to your Bible questions. See you then.